The 17 News at Sunrise podcast is brought to you by Clinica Sierra Vista.
Welcome back to the 17 News at Sunrise podcast, where we share your news on your schedule.
Working in the spirit of the Golden Empire, this is 17 News at Sunrise.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for waking up with us. I'm Natty Jansen, Alina Rusk in today for Alex. We begin this morning in your 17 court watch. And second-degree murder charges have been dropped against two men in a deadly hit-and-run crash. The crash happened in March 2021. Investigators say three vehicles were racing when they became airborne at the intersection of Panama Lane and Stine Road. One of the drivers was killed. The driver and passenger in another vehicle are accused of leaving the scene. Prosecutors initially charged Javonte Murphy and Brian Dickerson with second-degree murder, but a judge reduced the charge to gross vehicular manslaughter due to the evidence. A third man, 22-year-old Devis Rufus, faces a misdemeanor charge of obstructing or delaying an investigation.
A former Bakersfield DMV employee has pleaded guilty to issuing commercial driver's licenses to unqualified drivers in exchange for bribes. Court records say 39-year-old Ulysses Pena had arranged for students in co-defendant Bingdrip Singh Panu's truck driving school to pass the written exams in exchange for payments. Pena would falsify the DMV records to show the students had passed even when they didn't. Pena is due back in court in December for sentencing and faces a maximum of 15 years.
Speaking of the DMV, Assemblyman Vince Fong has introduced a new law that would exempt Purple Heart recipients from paying licensing and registration fees. Fong says relieving vets with a Purple Heart from DMV fees is just one way we can honor them for their sacrifices.
Well, now to your 17 Crime Watch, a 14-year-old and 16-year-old are behind bars this morning after being arrested in connection with the brutal rape of a South Bakersfield woman. Court documents show the two boys entered through the window of the woman's home in the area of Brundage Lane and Union Avenue on September 6th. The teens allegedly held the victim for 4 hours, repeatedly raping her and bombarding her with racial slurs. Police saying both teens have been arrested and booked on several felony and sexual assault charges. The boys not named because of their ages.
And the Bakersfield Police Department's asking for the public's help finding a woman who allegedly used a stolen driver's license to test drive a vehicle and then never returned. Police say it happened on September 5th. If you have any information about the location of this woman or vehicle, you can call BPD. Today's the day. It's the kickoff of the Great Kern County Fair.
And you'll be able to visit all your usual favorites from years past, but there are some new attractions also debuting this year, including the Lumberjack Show. I'm excited for that one. And a petting farm.
The fair will also be bringing in seven new food vendors that will serve a variety of dishes, including Hawaiian bento and Italian sandwiches. And sweet treats like cobblers and pies. Oh, that's speaking my language.
Right.
The fair opens today at 4 p.m. and runs through October 2nd. Ticket costs $12 for adults. Kids under 5 get in for free.
So exciting. And of course, the fair will open early tomorrow for people with special needs and their caregivers. It's called Special Friends Day. The fair opening for them at 9 a.m. to noon for the attendees that fall in that group. There will also be several attractions to see that morning, including the Wilder Show and the pig races.
And Friday's Senior Day, free admission and parking for seniors age 62 and better. Gates open at 9 a.m. Opening ceremony is set to begin at 10. Senior Day will also feature trivia time and giveaways. And in the morning time, should be pretty nice out there. 17 News is your local election headquarters. In just 19 days, ballots for this year's midterm election will begin arriving in mailboxes across Kern County. Since 2020, our elections process has been under heightened scrutiny. 17's Maddie Gannon talks about the increased attention, coupled with California's universal vote-by-mail law, that has put a spotlight on the methods by which we cast our ballots.
Amid ultra-competitive races and high-stakes propositions, what may draw the most controversy this midterm election is simply how we turn our ballots in.
Golly, that's the one thing is as long as we have the mail-in ballots and allow ballot harvesting in the drop boxes, it's going to be a tough road to hoe living here in California.
As Taft Republican Assembly President Vince Maiocco points out, ballot harvesting can be one of the most confusing and contentious ways to cast a ballot. The practice involves a third party picking up a ballot a voter has filled out and dropping it off at a drop box or an elections department. In 2016, California changed its law to allow any third party, rather than just a relative or roommate, pick up and turn in ballots. This means campaigns or volunteers can knock on the doors of voters likely to vote in their party's favor, offer to help the voter fill out their ballot, and turn it in for them. The limitation is collectors can't be paid solely for the number of ballots they pick up.
To me, it's just a recipe for disaster.
Critics like Mayoko are concerned ballot harvesting could lead to someone voting in place of someone else or allow a third party to tamper with or throw out ballots.
I believe that in order to have a strong democracy, we need more people voting.
Proponents like Democratic analyst Neil Sinapa say the practice makes it easier for residents, especially those who work two or three jobs to cast a ballot.
If we can make it easier and more accessible, which, you know, ballot pickup or ballot harvesting does do that, then I think, you know, that's a good thing. Why wouldn't we want more people voting?
Republican analyst Kathy Abernathy argues more people voting due to ballot harvesting isn't necessarily a good thing.
That means you're getting ballots that don't really reflect the individual person. And so, to me, if 5% of America doesn't want to vote, okay. I'd rather people that actually knew what they were doing.
Maddie Gannon, 17 News.
And you can check your voter registration status online at voterstatus.sos.ca.gov or call the County Elections Department at 868-3590. If you're not signed up but you wish to receive a ballot in the mail, you have until October 24th to complete your registration. You can do that online at vote.ca.gov or in person at the elections office. You can find all of this information on our website, kget.com.
Now, state news, the city of South Lake Tahoe coming one big step closer to banning single-use plastic water bottles. Their city council unanimously approved the reading of the ordinance on the measure that would ban the use of plastic bottles less than a gallon in size at city facilities and events. Violators could face fines. If then approved by the city council, the ban would go into effect April of next year. The CEO of the South Lake Tahoe Chamber of Commerce spoke out opposing this proposed ban.
Mark Twain said, whiskey's for drinking and water's for fighting over. So I guess we have a fight on our hands here.
Some residents also raised concerns that the ordinance could lead to job losses, but many spoke out in favor of banning these bottles, saying they litter the lake. The final vote for approval expected next month.
538 now, Governor Gavin Newsom signed several new cannabis bills into law this week, including one that prohibits employers from firing workers based on a marijuana test. The bill makes California the seventh state in the U.S. that does not allow employers to discriminate against workers who smoke marijuana off the job and away from the workplace. Supporters argue that THC tests don't indicate current impairment and can show a positive result even if the person consumed marijuana weeks prior. Historic flooding and loss of power hit Puerto Rico because of Hurricane Fiona, and there have been four deaths reported so far. Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer joined other voices demanding action to make Puerto Rico more resilient to hurricanes. Lawmakers spoke out saying it's time for the federal government to step up.
To help the people of Puerto Rico survive, recover, and rebuild stronger, and rebuild better, and rebuild in a more resilient way.
The head of FEMA traveled to Puerto Rico yesterday to assess damage and meet with local officials.
Now, Governor Newsom is sending a search and rescue team to Puerto Rico in response to Hurricane Fiona. A 15-member task force joining other teams from around the country, assisting in coordinating emergency operations in and around the hardest hit areas of the island. Puerto Rico's governor says it will be at least a week until authorities have a full estimate of the damage there. Most of the island now without electricity and running water for another day.
We were hoping it wouldn't be so big, but it was bigger than we expected, and you have to make do with what you have.
The voice of a translator there. Now, Puerto Rico's power grid still in rough shape after Hurricane Maria caused a complete blackout there 5 years ago.
Meantime, Hurricane Fiona has become a Category 4 storm, the storm moving away from the Turks and Caicos Island with maximum sustained winds near 130 miles per hour. Fiona is making its way toward Bermuda. A tropical storm watch is currently in effect for the area. According to weather experts, tropical storm conditions could reach Bermuda by late Thursday, early Friday. The storm's been blamed for causing at least four deaths as it tracked through the Caribbean.
All right, and now to news from around the nation. Well, a tentative Biden administration deal was announced last week to prevent a railroad worker strike. The possibility of one is still there. Not all unions are on board with this deal. Some members of the International Association of Machinists and Aerospace Workers have rejected the deal, the group delaying a strike until next Thursday for more negotiations. Votes by other unions that accepted tentative deals are now up in the air.
Also around the nation, 47 people have been charged for a fraud scheme during the COVID-19 pandemic. The DOJ says the 47 defendants are all linked to a group called Feeding Our Future, which claimed the money would be used to feed needy children in Minnesota during the pandemic. Instead, the government says the defendants bought fancy cars, pricey real estate, and took expensive trips. Federal prosecutors call it the largest pandemic relief fraud case charged so far.
The 17 News at Sunrise podcast is a production of KGET and Nexstar Media Group. For more on all of the headlines in today's show, head to KGET.com.